souls are going to take out of this place.
Amen.
Everybody's going to die. But the question is how you die. And not to say when you die. Because we don't control when we die. And here's what we control. We control how we die.
Amen.
And you cannot do it unless you are living your life a certain way.
Amen.
And what I want to say to all of the church members is that, brothers and sisters, we have to move beyond just being members of church.
Amen. That's right.
We have to move beyond that. That is good. But God does not judge you on your church membership. We've been studying the Beatitudes, what it means to be blessed by God. You want to live your life under the blessing of God.
Yeah.
And what does that mean? There are certain things you have to understand. That once you become a Christian and you're living right for God, you then are marked by the devil. Because the devil does not want you living right for God. So he's going to come against you in all kind of ways. And a lot of people in the church, they join the church, and they think that just because they join the church, that life is going to be so easy, and you're just going to, you know, just kind of flow through this thing. That's not how it works. That's not how it works. And then people get disappointed when they come into the church, and then they go through a whole lot of things in their life, and people get disappointed, and they go through things and being in the church, and they get disappointed. But they didn't read the fine print. Amen? And to read the fine print, it said that there were certain things, once you gave your life to Jesus Christ, that you were going to go through. Now, I want to take y'all through it today. I'll take you through today. If you'll turn with me in the book of Matthew 5, and we've been studying this, I'm going to end today with the last three Beatitudes. This is important. These are the three that are most significant to you, amen, that you have to understand these three so that you don't get discouraged. Because if you don't understand these three, you're going to get discouraged. You have to understand, I don't have much voice left, so I don't know how much I'm going to be able to do. So I may have the chief priest, amen. But if you will look at, with me at Matthew 9, 10, and 11, and then verse 12. 12 and 11 basically go together. Amen? If you will stand as we read the word of God. Amen? Here's what it says. Verse number 9. Blessed are the who?
Peacemakers.
Blessed are the peacemakers, not troublemakers. Not hell raisers. Come on now, y'all. Amen. But it said what?
Peacemakers.
For they will be called sons, daughters of God. My other translation said they will be called children of God. So that when you're a peacemaker, you're a child of God. Okay? Okay. So if Reverend Harris is raising hell, he's not a child of God. Amen. That's what the book says to me. Amen. If I'm raising hell in my household, then I'm not a what? I'm a child of God. Amen. Here's the other one. This is good. Verse 10. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness. Because of righteousness. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Your reward is heaven.
Amen.
Watch this. Verse 11. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me.
Yes.
Not because of the pastor.
All right.
Not because of your spouse.
All right.
But because of who?
Jesus.
Because of Jesus. He said, rejoice and be glad.
Right.
I'm stopping right there. Rejoice and be glad. So then it goes on to say, they did the same thing to people before you.
That's right.
Amen. That you are not the only person that's going through something. You may have a seat, because I'm going to teach today on rejoice and be glad. Now watch this, because I'm going to do a little differently than I did in the first service. I want to take you through this, because again, you know, I don't have much of a word, but listen. The last three Beatitudes, and this is significant, are the ones that those of us who are in the church struggle with the most. They're the ones who struggle with the most. Here's why. Because we have a difficult time dealing with people, praise God, who attack us and talk bad about us and insult us. We have a problem with that. We have a problem with people who are mean to us in the church. We have a real problem with that. And I know we come to church and we talk about how Christian we are.
Yes.
But a lot of times you can tell when folk are mad and messed up because of what people are doing to them in their lives.
Yeah.
And we have a real problem with that. We have such a problem that sometimes we won't even talk to one another in the church when someone in the church has made us mad. But we say we love God. Come on now. And when we say we are filled with the Holy Ghost, praise God, we say those things.
Yes, right.
We get our shout on, we get our praise on in the church.
Amen.
But yet sometimes we won't speak to people
yes.
who are in our own congregation, and we won't even sit by them. Why? Because they have made us mad.
Huh.
They made us mad. So we have a problem with that. And here's what Jesus is doing. Jesus is challenging us and calls us to live by kingdom values. Not by worldly values. Not by worldly values. Brothers and sisters, if we're going to be Christians, we have to live by what the Word of God says. Amen. That's our goal. We're trying to live by what the Bible teaches. Amen. So that, you know, there is no other way. When I die, God's going to judge me on whether or not I have lived according to His Word. God's not going to judge me on the fact that I have been a United Methodist pastor. I've been pastoring since I was 17. That is irrelevant. That is irrelevant when I stand before God. God's going to judge me on whether or not I have lived by what the Word of God said. And I'm trying to live out my Christian faith. That's what God's going to judge me by. Now here's what he said. Here's what he said. The world has one standard, brother, and you just gave your life to Jesus Christ. What the Bible says is, you cannot live by the standard that you lived by before you got saved.
Yes, yes.
That now you have given your life to Christ, Jesus is saying, you got to live a different way. Because if you don't live a different way, then you are not really one of his disciples. You hear what the Bible's saying. This is deep. The Bible said, when you look at verse number 9, it says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Jesus calls believers to be peacemakers. Okay. You are not to stir nothing up in your household. And now I'm going to get to the outside. But we're going to work on the inside first. Because a lot of times we try to act one way on the outside. And it goes about our marriages, our relationships. Are we peacemakers, sister? Are we stirring up stuff in our lives? Come on now. And here's what is interesting. You can always tell how somebody's living when they start talking about their relationship with God if they're married by looking at their spouse.
Yeah.
I know what y'all looking for. Because the Bible says we're called to be peacemakers. Well, what does that mean? To be a peacemaker involves action.
Amen.
It's not what Brother Thomas what I say, but Brother Thomas what I do. Here's what the Bible says. When you look in the Bible and praise God, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. And then here's what it says in verse 18. All this is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation.
Amen.
So, girl, what the Bible says is that once you got saved, God then put on you a ministry. What is the ministry? a ministry of reconciliation. So, brother, you just didn't get saved to be saved, but God now saved you to have a ministry of reconciliation. The ministry of reconciliation is, how do I use my life in such a way to bring about peace? Well, what are you talking about? I'm talking about so that my life reflects that of Christ. So that, you know, you and him, you know, are David. You are a Christian. You ought not to be creating bitterness and strife in the relationship. Amen. Why? Don't be looking over here now. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, follow me now. Amen. Why? Because you are a Christian. What governs your life is not your feelings and your emotions, but the Word of God. So when you feel like hitting him because of what he did, you don't do it. Why? Because God is calling you to be a what?
A peacemaker.
A peacemaker. Amen. A peacemaker. Amen. Amen. Now see, this is what, you know, this is what you can now use.
Come on now.
Amen. He's going to use it too. Amen. But now she can use it on you. Amen. Because if somebody looks at her and you get jealous, the Bible says you ain't supposed to go off because someone is admiring what is yours. It is yours, right? Amen. Praise God. But the Bible calls you to be a what?
Peacemaker.
A peacemaker. So you're not involved in what's causing bitterness and strife. But your ministry is to bring about peace and harmony. Now here's what's going to blow your mind. This is what troubled me. I went over to Romans, the 12th chapter. Y'all turn with me to Romans 12. Romans 12. Look at verse 17 and 18. Here's what it says. Romans 12, verse 17 and 18. If you look up on the screen, I'm going to have everybody read that together. If everybody, can we read that together?
Yes.
Let's read that together. Do not. Hold up. It says, be careful to do what is what?
Right.
In the eyes of who?
Everybody.
It does not exclude anybody. It said, my responsibility. And I'm not messing with you today, but you just a good sport. Amen. Praise God. And the Bible says that it is my responsibility. That's what it said. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. Not just church members, not just at home, but everybody. Now notice what it said. Keep reading verse 18.
If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone.
As far as it depends on who?
You.
You look at yourself and say you.
You.
Amen. It's me. As far as it depends on me. To do what?
Live
at peace. What the Bible's trying to say is you control what's going on in your life. Just because somebody's not living in peace with you doesn't mean you don't have to live in peace with them.
Amen.
Because you control it. Amen. You control that, Brother Fields. Amen. Now, Barbara may not be happy with you, but that don't mean you don't have to be unhappy with her. Because you got some control over that. Amen. You can just let her be unhappy and say what she got to say, but you gonna keep watching the ball game. Amen. Praise God. And you're not going to let a word come out of your mouth. Amen. You just going to let it swoop over you. Amen.
Amen.
Because you control that. Now you can get with her. And if you get with her, then what's going to happen?
Yeah.
She's going to put it out. You're going to be calling me up for a room. Okay. See, here's what I'm teaching. You have control over that. God's calling you to be a peacemaker. Okay? God's not having sister deals. You just do what you're supposed to do. And the Bible says you are blessed. Because the blessing is you now are a child of God. Not a member of bonds. See, that won't get you in. But what gets you in is you're a child of God. Now watch this, because here comes the deep part of this. Here comes the deep part of it. Notice what it said. Then I gave my life to Jesus Christ. I'm coming to church, and I'm expecting certain things to happen when I come to church. I've given my life to Christ. I'm trying to do right. Here's what Jesus said in verse 10. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness. Okay. Now, sometimes we create mess in our own lives. And then we get persecuted, sister, because we have created mess in our own lives. Jesus said, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about when you're persecuted because you're trying to live right for God.
Yes. Amen. Amen.
So when you're trying to live right for God, then here's what it is. The devil then is going to come against you because now you are trying to live right for God.
Amen.
You know, I was telling my wife the other day, there used to be a time when I could wear my collar. Used to be a time. And people would respect that. Used to be a time when they would respect that. Alonzo, they don't do that anymore. People don't speak. They don't have no respect for the collar. It's because of where they are. They don't have respect that you're trying to live right for God. And sometimes we get so caught up into this that we expect people to pat us on the back because we're trying to live right for God. No, baby, the devil will offend you. I want you to know that the devil will offend you. The devil doesn't care that you go to church every Sunday. The devil doesn't care that you go to Bible study 3 times a week. The devil doesn't care that you got an active prayer life. The devil doesn't care that you give your money to the church. The devil doesn't care about that. And you know what? The world doesn't care about what you are doing for God. The Bible said you're going to be persecuted for righteousness' sake. Amen. Because some folk are not going to like that you are now living right for God. Matter of fact, some folk, even in your family, don't like the fact that you are not what you used to be. So they don't find a way to persecute you because you are living right for God. They always want to bring up what you used to do and where you used to hang out and where you used to go. They don't give God any credit for the fact that you are not what you used to be. Or they want to go in the faith that you're not perfect. Baby, I never said I was perfect. I'm a child. I never said I was perfect.
Yes.
But what I am is a child of God. And I'm not what I used to be. I'm a child.
Amen.
People don't throw that in your face. The Bible said, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And here's what verse 11 said. It picks up on it. Blessed are you when people insult you. Oh my goodness. When people do what?
Insult you.
Insult you. Okay?
Have mercy.
Persecute you. And notice what it said. And say falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Watch this, Shayla. Here's what the word says. Here's what the word says. That there will be people who will offend you. They're going to disrespect you.
Yes.
And listen, sister, every now and then they're going to talk crazy to you. Okay, amen.
Amen.
The question is, when they talk crazy to you, what do you do?
Amen.
Okay, don't say a word. You're going to pray for them, don't say a word. You're going to try to pray for them. Now see, you're going to regress already. See that quick? She's just going to regress already. Amen. I'm going to pray for them, but I'm going to try to pray for them. You gotta make sure it's sincere, amen. But we gotta get you so it's sincere, amen.
That's right.
Amen. Your husband coming back now, amen. Praise God, amen. Here's the other one. They want to talk to you. Then it says, people will persecute you. Don't you know that you are the target of the devil?
Yes.
God delivered you. Remember when God delivered you? God did not want you delivered. I mean, God wants you delivered. The devil didn't want you delivered. God delivered you, but the devil didn't want you delivered.
Amen.
So what the devil does, here's what he does. Here's what he does. Come on, sister. Come on, sister. Here's what he does. The devil knows everything about you. Here's what he does. He's good at this. He will bring up stuff
yes, sir.
From your past that cause you to be in captivity. Y'all not listening to me. Y'all trying to figure out why that stuff came back on you? Listen, what the devil's trying to do is, the devil wants you to think that you are not nothing. Amen. So what he does, Kenny, is he targets people.
Yes.
Because you are living right for God. So he targets you, he tries to persecute you, because he thinks if he can put enough pressure on you, come on now, if he can offend you enough, then you're going to go back to the old self. Because you remember when you used to handle things your way? Okay. Remember now. You know, you don't still have that in your purse, do you? You know, I still got it in my purse. That's okay. Just because I have a prize bag, I still got it in my purse. I still got it in my car. I still got it in my truck. Just in case.
Just in case.
I know he said go left your farm, and this ain't going to prosper. But just in case the laws are under the base. Amen. Praise God. Just in case. Amen. Just in case. Listen. People will seek to hurt you. People will seek to destroy you. And watch this. People will seek to damage you. People are going to lie on you. They will lie about who you are. They will lie about your character. They will lie to make you look bad. They will lie to destroy your image.
Yes.
They don't like people thinking a whole lot of you. So they got to lie. They got to bring you down. They got to get you off that pedestal. So they got to tell some lie to get you off that pedestal.
Amen.
So the Bible says you got to understand what you are up against. Because you join church and just because you sing in the choir, family, that doesn't mean anything to the devil. He's got to bring you down.
Yes, amen, amen.
You hear what the Bible says. And what happens is, Michael, then we so frustrated that people lie on us. That a lot of we get distressed about it.
Yes, yes.
You know, we get distressed about it. So we want to run to a new church. Because they lie on us over there. But let me tell you something. They got some folk over there down the street of Pure.
That's right.
So when you go down the Pure, I want you to know them lying spirits are down the Pure. And you need Pure when they go down to New Era. Don't you know them lying spirits are at New Era? And if you know the Holy Angel, I want you to know there's some unholy angel.
Yes. Amen.
Jesus said, when people lie on you, when people persecute you, you know, I made me look healthy right quick. When people say bad things about you, when people seek to destroy you, when your enemy slanders you, Jesus said, don't pout about it. But Jesus said, rejoice. This is what I like about this.
Yes.
And be glad. Now, how can I rejoice and be glad when people are persecuting me, saying bad things about me, trying to destroy me and to slander me? Jesus said, rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven.
Yes.
I got a reward in heaven. And you know what? I just don't believe heaven up there. But I believe I'm going to get another heaven up there. So I believe that God's going to bless me down here. And I learn how to rejoice and learn how to praise my way through this world. Because every now and then, I got to learn how to rejoice and be glad. That's why some Sunday mornings when I get out of my car at 6 o'clock in the morning and come into the church, rejoicing spirit, because I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it. Because Jesus says, so they persecuted the prophets that are before you. You ought to be glad Joshua was talked about. David, they tried to kill him. Deborah was persecuted. Esther was persecuted. Daniel was persecuted. Hannah was persecuted. Gideon was persecuted. Samson was persecuted. Isaiah was persecuted. Jeremiah was persecuted. I'm in good company now. Was talked about. Hosea was lied on. I'm into good company. They persecuted Ruth. They persecuted Naomi. They persecuted Sarah. I'm in good company now. They lied on Peter. They crucified Jesus. They hung Paul upside down. I'm in good company now. They reminded he was persecuted.
And man can't take away, amen. Yeah.